Hi there. I've been watching him. He finds a safe place, stops, and stands well back from the curb. He always stops before crossing the road, looks and listens, and off he goes, looking and listening all the way. He's great. I'm going down. Congratulations. You really know what you're doing. Always use the green cross code, because I won't be there when you cross the road.
Super baddie Darth Vader up to no good at all again in The Empire Strikes Back. David Prowse, how did a West Country boy get to be one of the nastiest men in the galaxy?
It's amazing, isn't it? I was sat at home one day and I got a phone call from my agent saying, can I go and see George Lucas? And I went up to the 20th Century Fox office and George said, look, I'm making this film, which is sort of space fantasy, and I've got two parts I'd like you to consider. And I said, well, tell me what they are. And he said, well, the first part's a part of a character called Chewbacca. I said, what in the hell's Chewbacca? And he said, it was like a furry type gorilla that goes through the film on the side of the goodies. And I thought, I turned my nose up. I thought, well, I don't fancy sort of, you know, 3 months in a gorilla skin. I said, what's the other one? And he said, well, the other one's the big villain of the film. I said, say no more, George, I'll take it. And he said, well, you would never regret this decision. And this is the result.
Was he right? Have you ever regretted it? Because Chewbacca's a very likable character.
Yeah, Chewbacca's likable, but I think Darth Vader is much more an established character in the picture. And I think he's actually become virtually the cult figure of the science fiction world.
Yes, he has indeed. Yeah. I mean, do you get adopted by science fiction societies?
Not so much adopted, but I now get requests to go and do all the science fiction conventions in America. I've got a whole tour lined up for the summer.
And what do? You just sweep on in this gear?
No, I go on as myself, because you see, the big interest is to see who's behind Darth Vader. And so I go on and I really talk about my career, and I, because I've been in the business, people don't realize I've been in the business for 15 years. I've become an overnight success.
What were you doing before the phone rang?
I'm in the health business as well, and up until Star Wars, I really never ever thought of myself as an actor, although, as I said, I've been in the business since 1965. I've done a whole succession of films and television commercials and TV series. You know, I was in all the major TV series like The Saint and Department S and Beverly Hillbillies. And as I said, I've done about 20 odd films before Star Wars came along. I did things like Clockwork Orange and Up the Chastity Belt, Up Pompeii, Casino Royale.
And of course you're the Green Cross Man, aren't you?
And the Green Cross Man.
How tall are you? About that?
Well, I'm 6'6 and I weigh about 19 stone. But the Green Cross Code and Darth Vader came at the same, almost exactly the same period. In fact, the Star Wars people gave me a week off to go and film the Green Cross Code commercials, and it's marvelous because Darth Vader has given the Green Cross Code man a lot of publicity.
Curious double casting,
yeah. It is, yes, because I'm the sort of the goodie on one side and the baddie on the other. And at one time, the Department of Transport nearly sacked me because they thought my image as Darth Vader would have a detrimental effect on my image as the Green Cross Code man.
It strikes me that wearing this mask, you can't see a heck of a lot, can you?
No, you have terrible vision problems. Number one, they put darkened lenses in. And of course, because of the shape of the mask, you really can't see anything further than about sort of 10 feet in front of you on the floor. So your vision really starts at about 10 feet away, so you can't see steps and things in front of you. My vision, most of my vision downwards, comes out of this breathing hole just there, which is like a Gaul's affair. And then when we were doing the big fight sequence at the end, where we had to have more vision, we actually made another mask with a perspex bottom so that you could actually see better, you know, down below.
But the heat is fairly intense, presumably.
The heat is absolutely fantastic, because not only, you see, when they made the mask, first of all, they made the mask miles too big. And then when George asked me to turn right and left, I sort of turned right and left, and the mask still stayed facing forward. So they padded the whole of the inside of the mask out with foam rubber. And of course that made you perspire even more, and the least bit of exertion, the eyepiece is messed up and you have to stop everything and clean out the eyepieces and see where you're going. And I said in the big fight sequence at the end, you know, you'd walk through the set and then have to be led back by three people.
The voice, of course, you don't provide. Do you find it frustrating as an actor not to be performing vocally?
Yes, terribly. I performed all the way through the picture. Because I have to learn all the dialogue, and the other actors in the film have to react to me and things like this.
But then they read up.
But then they read up. Yeah, I think the problem was, as you obviously realise, I have a West Country accent.
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
very slight. And I don't think they could do Darth Vader with an English accent. That was the big problem. And also, you see, the character being a big black character that he is, I think George really wanted an obvious black voice, and they got James Earl Jones in to do it. And to me, that is a very obvious Negro voice. And Anyway, it's a nice combination, I think. I mean, it's frustrating for me, obviously, yeah. Because, you know, I'm not having you.
I see you're wearing your trusty, what's it called, lightsaber.
That's the lightsaber, yeah.
Is that the one you use in the movie?
That's not the one I use, but it's very, very, very similar. In the first ones that we used on the first film, they had a very fast revolving motor inside. It's almost like a double-handled torch, you know. And then they put this sort of carbon rod, about 4 foot long, which was the actual lightsaber itself. And then they put reflective tape over the rod, and then as soon as you switched on, the whole thing revolved very fast and looked as though it was pulsating. On the one that we've just finished, on the original ones, they were very, very fragile. You know, Sir Alec Guinness himself were fighting merrily away, and every time they clashed, you know, you'd pick up the bits off the floor, and so you kept on having to start and stop and start.
Indeed,
and
you
stop.
Picked up the bits of Sir Alec Guinness off the floor.
I picked up Sir Alec Guinness once off the floor as well.
Yeah. David, thank you very much.
Thank you. Nice talking to you.